keep the devil in the night. Shut the door, keep out the devil. Light a candle, everything's all right. Light a candle, everything's all right.
Oh, when I was a holy child.
Shut the door, keep out the devil.
Good and bad was just a game.
Shut the door, keep the devil in the night.
Many years and many trials.
Shut the door, keep out the devil.
They proved to me they're not the same.
Shut the door, keep the devil in the night.
I say
shut the door, keep out the devil. Shut the door, keep the devil in the night. Shut the door, keep out the devil. Light the candle, everything's all right. Light the candle, everything's all right.
Oh, Satan is an evil charmer.
Shut the door, keep out the devil.
He's hungry for us all to hurt.
Shut the door, keep the devil in the night.
And without your holy armor.
Shut the door, keep out the devil.
He will hit you for dessert.
Shut the door, keep the devil in the night. Shut the door, keep out the devil. Shut the door, keep the devil in the night. Shut the door, keep out the devil. Light the candle, everything's all right. Light the candle, everything's all right. Say the hey, 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 shut the door. Hey, 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 shut the door. Hey, hey, you better shut the door. Say your prayer, he won't be back no more. Shut the door, keep out the devil. Shut the door, keep the devil in the night. Shut the door, keep out the devil. Light the candle, everything's all right. Light the candle, everything's all right.
You better shut the door,
keep out the devil.
You better shut the door,
keep the devil in the night.
Shut the door,
keep out the devil.
Children,
light the candle, everything's all right. Light the candle, everything's all right. Light the candle, everything's all right. Light the candle, everything's all right.
Our General Conference Families Directors, we have Pastor Willie and Elaine Oliver from the General Conference office. In their spare time, they enjoy taking long walks, beach vacations, gardening, exotic cuisines, and spending time with family and friends. This year, 2017, the church decided to have a beautiful theme. I don't know if you are aware, today we have this. Family, arise, shine, Jesus is coming. Beautiful theme. I believe the music of the gospel harmony, we have the happiness in our heart, not just harmony the way they sing, but we have the message that we could contemplate based on our theme. This morning, allow me to share message coming from the scripture, coming from the councils of our dear sister Ellen White. And today's message entitled, A Prescription for Family Happiness. As I look at our leaders from the General Conference, they spend a lot of time for their families. They love so much their families. Look at Ted Wilson. They have that time to go to nature. They visit places. So today, our study will be focused on the book of Luke chapter 6, verse 31. You can compare to Matthew chapter 7, verse 12. Before we continue, I would like to ask you to please bow your heads as we seek the Lord in prayer. Gracious Father, a few moments from now, we are going to hear your words, your counsel, your warning, preparing your church for your soon return. Lord, inspire us through the power of your Holy Spirit. Possess each one, that our focus will be in the heavenly things. Thank you, Lord, that you will feed our soul today. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. A pastor decided to observe the people who came to quietly pray at his church. One day, the door opened, and an old man wearing a ragged shirt came through the foyer, or to the lobby, and into the sanctuary. He approached the platform, knelt down, and bowed his head. And after a few moments, the bedraggled-looking man got up and left. In the following days, always at noon, the same scene was repeated. And each time the visitor knelt at the front of the church, he also sat down and opened, of course, his lunchbox. Later on, the pastor, curiosity, he rose and he approached and asked the stranger what he was doing. The elderly man said his name was John and that he was a factory worker in a nearby neighborhood. He explained that each day after eating his lunch, he reserved time to pray. He chose to spend a few quiet moments with God in this church since it was close to his workplace. The worker then whispered to the pastor the simple words to his daily prayer. Look at his prayer. Here I am, Lord. Once more, I want to tell you how happy I am since we become friends. Thank you for forgiving all my sins. Though I don't really know how to pray, I just want to express my desire to love and to live for you today. The pastor was stunned at the genuine faith of the man wearing dirty clothes kneeling beside him. He told the factory worker that he was always welcome to pray and to come to church to pray. And then later on, my friends, the kneeling visitor replied, "Thank you. Now it's time for me to go." He quickly stood and left the church. But the pastor, my friend, quietly knelt also in the same place with reverence he never had before. Something amazing happened to the clergyman. He had a powerful encounter with Jesus. Tears ran down his face as he repeated the old man's prayer. Here I am, Lord. Once more, I want to tell you how happy I am since we become friends. Thank you for forgiving all my sins. Though I don't really know how to pray, I just want to express my desire to love and to live for you today. Friends, one day, the pastor noticed that John hadn't shown up at noon to pray. He became worried when several days went by and the old man still didn't come to the church. So the pastor went to the nearby factory and learned that John was sick and had been admitted to the hospital. The pastor went immediately to visit his friend. On the day, the pastor realized that he was there. With that excitement, quickly learned that John's presence at the hospital was having an impact on patients and staff. The old man's joy was contagious to everyone who came around him. As the pastor sat by the bedside of the smiling factory worker, the head nurse came into the room. She whispered to the pastor, "I can't understand how John can be so joyful. When nobody comes to visit him, he never received cards, flowers, or even phone call." My friend, later on, when the nurse left the room, the old man leaned forward in his bed and smiled at the pastor. The nurse is wrong, according to John. She doesn't know that a visitor comes to see me every day at noon. My dear friend sat by my side, holds my hands, and looks at me. And he says, "I want to tell you how happy I am Since we become friends, I love you to hear your prayers and think about you every day. I am here today to tell you, keep loving and living for me. Friends, prescription for family happiness. Number one, we can see the verbs of good family relationship. This little story holds the key to family happiness. The word there, loving and what? Living. This formula is also found in our opening Bible text, our scripture reading. Do to others as you would have them do to you. This is a common point between the prayer of the factory worker and the words of Christ. Both speak about living and loving. Both contain verbs that teach us about being happy family. As I look at our leaders from the ECSD, this is our president, Pastor Samuel Soh. He had that kind of love and he has experienced that. He put that practice. And in order for a man to be a good husband, he must know how to love and how to live. The same is true for wives and children. We all need to love others and live for others. For the Christian, these two verbs cannot be separated. I believe your family will become a happy family. In order for all of us to experience that, remember those two verbs, loving and living. I know that our leaders from the local union also experience that kind of love as a family. And I believe loving and living unite theory and practice. Loving and living give support to our words and reasons of our actions. When we separate loving and living, our relationship will fall apart. When we isolate our words from our actions, our feelings from our behaviors, and our talk from our walk, it creates hypocrisy. You are not really sincere. You are pretending. So today, friends, very simple words, but very challenging. We can say we are loving, we are living, but the moment we pretend, the moment we have that insincerity, we are not doing the right perspective that God has given us. The Lord wants us to have a wider lesson from this experience. Loving without living, or living without loving, result in a host of family problems. By the way, I love our big family here in this church. And I am happy if there is harmony among us. I know God will be happy the moment he will see not only gospel harmony, but Church of Seventh-day Adventist, Silver Ramos Avenue, are in harmony with the Word of God. The Bible says here, it leaves others in our lives feeling empty and lonely. It leads us to demand from others, and when we don't get what we want, we become critical. Satan wanted to destroy relationship, even family. Look at our modern family today. In our meals, what happened? Suppose gadgets would not be there. I would like to encourage you to attend this afternoon. Pastor Suminda will explain how Satan trapped every family. Suppose there would be no gadgets in the table. We have to experience nice conversation with our family. We have to experience love and living that kind of example that God has given. Instead of praying first, what we did is we have to take picture first. And then later, we can upload on the Facebook. Is that true? Satan is trying to trap us, my friend. Sometimes our meals are not happy meals. There are sad meals that we can consider. But today, I would like to encourage you, loving and living for our God, for our Lord, our Savior, the moment we face food on our table. Ellen White says, go where? Apart from the destruction and dissipation of city life. You can give your children your companionship, where you can teach them to learn of God through his works and train them for lives of integrity and usefulness. Few hours or few minutes you can be on that table. You can express your love. Put off your cell phone. just like putting off Satan, shut the door for Satan. You know, it's very easy to provide some scandals in the Facebook. You know, you can do a lot of things. Satan wanted to destroy family. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15 and 16 says, redeeming the time because the days are what? Are evil. If you look at verse 15, circumspectly, meaning cautiously, wisely, we have to ask the wisdom from heaven how to manage our family. Because whether we like it or not, we are just like foolish men inside our family if we will not be careful on that. There are couples that always talk on things and the things they want buy. New car, new stereo, new clothing, what else? There are a lot of things that we spent in our experience here on earth that should be spent for the enrichment of love, relationship with each other, are spent on acquiring things. I am very sad. This is why it's no longer concern for their companionship and the relationship ends. They spent more time loving things and work instead for each other. As I look at my experience just last year, you can serve this family because of family feuds. I had a wedding in San Carlos. A brother killed his younger brother because of some property. You have experienced this. We have heard this. It is clear in our eyes. That is why the basis of our happiness as a family, Ellen White says, those whose hearts are fully surrendered to God and who take His word as their guide will know how to conduct themselves in all the duties of life. Today, remember those verbs, loving and living for Jesus today. Number two, the formula of God, family relationship. The formula of good family relationship always contains both loving and living. We erode our family's happiness. It's just like grinding down if you will not follow that formula. Notice how this happens when people try to understand Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25. The Bible says, the husband is the what? The head of the wife. And also wives should submit to their husbands. You can see here, Paul gives us the counsel. It's just like, husband, you are the leader, you are the priest, you are the minister. You have to provide the needs of your family. Wives, you have also to help your husband. You have to manage your family. So today, I believe with all my heart that we have that counsel to follow as we work this theme, Arise, Shine, Jesus is Coming. Verse 25 says, husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her. When we isolate these statements from this context, it is same as separating love from living. Husbands can read part of Paul's words and believe they can act like a dictator and treat their wife like a slave. That is why it is important to read this entire teaching on this topic. I believe that this is a precious gift of God, love. You have read Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. The fruit of the Spirit is what? Is love. It's very clear. You will have joy, you will have peace, you will have patience, you will have kindness, you have gentleness, and you will have long-suffering or self-control. So you can love your enemies. The Bible says, if you look at Matthew chapter 5, verse 44, but if you can consider some, it's the Bible commentary says you cannot give your affection, your emotion, your filial love to your enemies. You can still respect them. But by emotion, as I look at the scripture, clearly today we have a great example coming from the Word of God. So families, you are here to serve and to care. The Apostle Paul teaches that a husband has the responsibility to serve and care for his wife. He shows that a wife serves through submission, but a husband serves his wife through sacrifice. Are you listening? I hope so. We have to practice that. Husband serves his wife through sacrifice. He must be willing to die for her. Amen? Wives hearing today, your husband willing to die for you. Just like Christ willing to die for us, dying for us. I'm sorry for using some pictures, but the greatest among you should be like the youngest and the one who rules like the one who serves. Luke chapter 22, verse 26. Jesus tells us that the greatest duty of a leader is to serve others. We shouldn't strive to be a great husband or wives, great parents or great children. We should try to be great Christians. I would like to repeat that word, great Christians. Amen? This will take care of everything else. True greatness in the eyes of God is to humbly love and live for others, all others in our families. In some other translation, our actions in our family will bring happiness to our homes. When we combine the two verbs, loving and living, they teach us that our goal in the family is not focused on getting our needs met. God did not create the family for us to gain satisfaction for ourselves at the expense of others. The family is a community of people that cooperates to fulfill everyone's needs. Happiness in the family comes when we adopt a servant's attitude. Friends, look at that word. Treat others the way you would like to be treated. A golden rule to follow, I believe, as Christian, in which we have to expect that we need have this kind of attitude that we have to experience here in our family. Treat others as you want to be treated. If you look at the Torah, it's very clear there that we have to experience that in our family. Happiness would be experienced. But sometimes Satan wanted to have family conflicts arises when individual members live in an immature, selfish, and unwilling to serve others. Hurt occurs in the hearts of family members. When we do not take the time to deeply understand the needs of others. If you think your words could hurt, do not continue to utter that kind of words. Today, there are many lessons on loving and living that will bring happiness to our homes. Number one, here are just a few more to keep in mind. Serve your family unselfishly. Don't expect rewards for doing kind deeds. Number two, be willing to give up your rights. When we demand our rights, we ignore the needs of others. It destroys the attitude of service in our heart. Number three, align your attitude with the teachings of Jesus. He became our servant. We are inclined not to notice the needs of others when we are concerned with our own pleasure. Number four, serve your family according to their needs. Learn to identify the specific needs of all family members and look for creative ways to satisfy them. And the last, number five, be a genuine servant. Put yourself into the shoes of other family members. Empathize with them. Friends, I hope that we can connect and we can experience such kind of love in our family. The last lesson, the result of good family relationship. At this point, you might think that a happy family requires everyone to be like saints. That's partly true and partly false. Look at the scriptures, Leviticus chapter 11, verse 44. I am the Lord your God. Consecrate yourselves and be what? Be holy, because I am what? I am holy, we have a song, take time to be what? To be holy, the world rushes on. Spend much time in secret with Jesus alone. I believe, my friends, this morning, we have to cherish that kind of habit. A saint, in the best sense of the world, is someone who gives him or herself completely to God. It doesn't mean that person never made mistakes or is infallible, but it does describe someone striving for a higher level of spirituality and a deeper walk with God. A saint will reveal an attitude of loving and living. This will be most clearly demonstrated in the family. Allow me to widen your minds through the spirit of prophecy. Adventist Home, page 317. He who would become a saint in heaven must first become a saint in his own family. Are you awake? Again, he who would become a saint in heaven must first become a saint in his own family. Oftentimes, we are nice when we are in church. We are kind, we are courteous when we are in our office, in our school, or wherever we are. But in our home, including myself, it's a big, big challenge. But reminding each one today, a warning, he who would become a saint in heaven must first become a saint in his own family. How's our living, our words, the way we converse with our children? Another one, just as you conduct yourself in your home life, you are registered in the books of what? Heaven. You can just imagine the recording angel doing those records. In your home itself, nobody knows. In your private life, the records are intact. Another one, parents, let not your religion be simply a profession, but let it become a what? A reality. This would be our prayer. 2017, almost half of the month, I believe we can start with Jesus. The quality of our human relationship reflects the quality of our relationship with God. Page 318. Where religion is a practical thing in the home, great good is accomplished. I believe in that statement. We believe today, do it Christians, we have the opportunity. As we can see, where there is lack of home religion, a profession of faith has no value. But when all members of the family engage in developing their faith, family relationship will not only bless the home itself, but will also be a light to our communities and our neighbors. Believe me, it will surely reflect the light, the very source. That true light illumines men. They are admonished to arise, shine. This is our theme. I believe our response to the true light, the moment we are connected to Him every day, it is to be a part that we can become a light bearer. The song says, light up that candle. Today, my friends, we are commissioned to shine, came to reflect the light of truth and the love of God. So today, don't forget that words, loving and living. I hope that they would agreeing each other. There would be communicating with each other. As Sister White says, testimonies for the church. Thank you for my dear friend Jasper here. Page 213. Not all who profess to keep the Sabbath will be sealed. There are many among those who teach the truth to others who will not receive the seal of God in their foreheads. They had the light of truth. They knew their master's will. They understood every point of our faith, but they had not corresponding works apart from our teachings, the way we live. I hope, my friends, that we will become consistent in our teachings, in our beliefs. Adding more testimonies for the church, volume 5, page 213. These who were so familiar with prophecy and the treasures of divine wisdom should have acted their faith. They should have commanded their household, remember the words, household after them, that by a well-ordered family, they might present to the world the influence of the truth upon the human heart. What an impact. The moment we will be able to show, to act that kind of love to other people. Early writings, page 120, I saw that the remnant were not prepared for what is coming upon the earth. Stupidity, like lethargy, seem to hang upon the minds of the most those who profess to believe that we are having the last message. Continue on. My accompanying angel cried out with awful solemnity. Anong iyahambal? What's the word? Get ready! Get ready! Get ready! For the first anger of the Lord is soon to come. His wrath is to be poured out and mixed with mercy. And ye are not ready. Rend the heart and not the garment. A great work must be done for the remnant. This message, my friend, several years ago. In fact, another one here, June 27, 1850. My accompanying angel said, time is almost finished. Do you reflect the lovely image of Jesus as you should? Then I was pointed to the earth, and so there would have to be a getting ready among those who have of the late embraced the third angel's message. You look at your Bible, Revelation chapter 14, verse 9. I hope you will not have that mark of the beast. Right now, we have seen the fulfillment of the prophecy. So, the cry of the angel again, get ready, get ready, get ready. Our family should be ready. Ye will have to die a greater death to the world that ye have ever yet died. I saw that there was a great work to be done for them, but little time in which to do it. Today, the challenge is very great. As I accepted that Adventist mission, Brother Asher, our city, progressive city, and I believe we can have the great mission to prepare families in the cities. And Bacolod, of course, our church, families here, would be able to share the message. But before sharing that, Christ Object Lessons, page 69, paragraph 1 says, Christ is waiting with longing desire for the manifestation of himself in his church. When the character of Christ shall be what? Perfectly reproduced in his people. Then he will come to claim them as his own. Are we matured? Are we complete in our Christian experience? Testimonies, volume 2, page 194. The long night of gloom is trying, but the morning is differed in mercy, because if the Master should come, so many would be found and ready. God's unwillingness to have his people perish has been the reason of so long delay. What amazing kind of love our Father had. Again and again, we have the council. We have Hargreaves, we have Peter Gregory, we have Manuel Vick, the incoming Emmanuel Vick. I hope that we have to practice that theory that we have learned. Oftentimes, we have read some counsels from the spirit of prophecy. But I believe those two verbs, loving and living, will always inculcate in our minds. Again, very interesting quotation from Adventist Home. Again and again, the Lord has instructed that our people are to take their families away from the cities. Very, very crucial. Into the country where they can raise their own provision. For in the future, the problem of buying and selling will be a very serious one. We should now begin to heed the instruction given us over and over again. Get out of the cities into rural districts where you will be free from the interference of enemies. In our present situation, sometimes water be contaminated, lack of supply, foods are not healthy anymore, maybe GMO or MSG. But if you have your place, your perfect gift to your children, a certain portion, I'm not saying that we will not do mission here in the city. I believe we were still preaching on the city. But your gift for your family, preparing ourselves for the soon coming of Jesus Christ. In spite of the wickedness, no doubt some Christian will continue to do missionary, visiting our friends here before its destruction. Philippians chapter 4, verse 9. Those things which ye have both learned and received, and heard and seen in me, do, and the God of peace shall be with you. Like the man at the beginning of the sermon, before I conclude, remember, God's prescription for family happiness has two ingredients. What is that? Loving and living. If they are separated, they are worthless. To live without loving or to love without living, it is meaningless. Our religious profession becomes cold and mechanical without love. So also our words of love are mere sentimentalism without loving fruit. So today, to summarize, the prescription for family happiness is found in putting these two verbs together, loving God and living this love in our families. When family members genuinely seek to love the Lord and live godly lives, our homes will become, it will like be a brilliant light in the dark world. You will become a shining light to the community. Before I sit down, may I ask you a solemn question? Do you desire to love the Lord and live for Him each day in your family? I pray that you will receive and practice every day in our Christian journey. Remember, our heavenly journey is a family affair. Again, our heavenly journey is a family affair. My beloved brothers and sisters, loving and living, remember these words. I am here today not just to educate you, but to warn you because I love you so much. I'm praying for you that our family would follow that theme this year, 2017. Arise, shine, Jesus is coming. If this is our last Sabbath on this earth, then are we ready to bring our family in heaven? Believe me, what is heaven without them? What is heaven without them? I'm praying for all of you. And by God's mercy, we will remain loving and living for Jesus. And by His grace, with our whole family together, it is our earnest desire to love and live just for Jesus today and forevermore. See you in heaven soon. God bless.